إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فهو المهتد، ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. وبعد، the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, تهادوا تحابوا. Go ahead, give each other gifts. Give gifts to each other. Why? تهادوا تحابوا. It will bring love into the hearts of you and the other party. تهادوا تحابوا. A هدية, a gift. When somebody gives you a gift, it is a reason to water the seeds of love in my heart and in his heart. And we always, do you give gifts? When you love someone, do you give gifts? When I give a gift, it represents me. It represents how I think. It represents perhaps my wealth. It represents my attributes, my character. Have you received Allah's gift? Allah gave us a gift. Allah gives many gifts. But there is a very special gift that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to all of us. And it's a gift that the reason for it is tahabu. It will plant those seeds, water those seeds of love in your heart. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, إِنَّمَا أَنَا رَحْمَةٌ مُهْدَى. Surely, verily, I, him sallallahu alayhi wasallam, is rahmah, love, compassion, gifted. Have you ever seen Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam as a, you know, rahmah? Allah's ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And when he wants to manifest this in this world, he manifests it in so many things. But he's telling us, especially those ummah, especially the people sitting here today, I've given you a gift of rahmah, a gift of compassion. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran. But he says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, why? In a very interesting way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks to people who are concerned. Good believers, good people. I see many of them. We really want to be close to Allah. I really want to make it to Jannah. I want to be a better Muslim. I want to be a better person. But things aren't easy. It is not easy. It's hard. Sometimes I can't go against myself. What can I do? I'm afraid. Because for a person that sincerely loves, his biggest fear is what? Separation. Separation anxiety. The one I love, I can't reach her or I can't reach him. I have a separation anxiety. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says the following in the Quran. قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهِ. Say, if you really love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, follow me. Follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Allah will love you this special love. We look at this verse and we interpret it the following way, which is correct. A sign of me loving Allah is what? Following Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we say this is a proof of love. If you claim to love Allah, show me how you're following Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Correct interpretation. But there is another way to interpret this verse. You look at it from that perspective. Allah is consoling those who really want to be close to Allah. And they're afraid, I won't make it. The journey is so far. There is so many obstacles on the way. I won't be able to make it. So Allah says, for all you who love me, all you who wants to be with me, and you're afraid that you'll get misguided, you're afraid that you won't make it, I responded to your plea. I sent a guide for you that is going to take you by the hand and bring you to me. Follow him. So Allah in this verse is saying, what? Oh, you, those of you who are interested in me, I am making it easy for you. I'm not going to leave you alone. I've sent my gift of love and compassion. He will tell you what to do. Follow him, be with him. Accept his plea. When he tells you, come, say yes, and he will take you to me. How is our relation with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam? There were those who lived in his time and they had a personalized relation with him. And the khutbah today is about this word, personalized. Is your relation with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam personal? There is a difference between I love someone, I heard about a great king, a great man living in, you know, a different country. I love him, but I don't have any relation with him. You can love Umar ibn al-Khattab or Khalid ibn al-Walid or any other person. You can love Einstein for all what I care. But do you have a personal relation with him? I don't. So The question today is not just loving Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Can I have a personal relation with him? Because those who did, it changed them. We have this story, very interesting, about this young man, Rabi'a ibn Ka'b al-Islami. Young man, heard about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, loved what he heard about him. And he decides to immigrate, he's living in Islam, to Medina, to be with him. He goes, after taking his parents' permission, he was this young teenager, parents are very important, right? Takes their permission, they grant him permission, he leaves, not permission to leave the house and be with my friends, permission to leave, to be with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he goes, and he's in Medina, and he's not that rich, so what does he do? He decides, I'm going to have a job as a servant of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he works with Anas ibn Malik. I'm Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sir. That's my job. He stays by the masjid min ahl al-Suffa, dedicating him time. I just want to be with this man. And he heard wonders. He narrates to us, among the things that he narrates, he said one day I served Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam so much. See, brothers and sisters, ليس المحب من تبذل له بل المحب من يبذل هو لك. Love, a person saying I love you, and then you serving him, that's not love. A true lover is one that serves you, not ask you to serve him. Love makes service easy. Have you ever loved someone so much that when that person tells you, can I have a glass of water, you're so happy I can do so? That was Rabi'a ibn Ka'b al-Islam. He loved Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam so much. He loved serving him. And he tells us this. One day, I was with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Night time comes, khalas, he goes to his house. It's time for him to leave, right? But Rabi'a ibn Ka'b al-Islam, he said, what if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wakes at night time and he needs a drink, he needs something, who's going to serve him? Let me stay. He said, I stayed at the doorstep of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, waiting for him. And he said, now he hears wonders. He said, the whole night I can hear Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, Subhanallah, Subhanallah wa bihamdi, Subhanallah, Subhanallah, al-hawa. The whole night. Can you say Subhanallah for 5 hours? What does that say about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? What is, he's in a state where he's praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Rabi'a ibn Ka'b al-Islam sleeps, wakes up, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is in tasbih. In the morning, he wakes up, the Prophet opens the door, here is Rabi'a on his doorman. So he tells him, Ya Rabi'a, what happened? And he says, oh Prophet of Allah, I was so worried that you might wake up in the night and you might need something. Who will serve you? I couldn't take it. I just decided to stay here, just in case you wake up. So he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, seeing this young man, he tells him, Ya Rabi'a, you know, he loves him. So, Ya Rabi'a, sa'alni, ask me, I'll give you. What do you want? Do you want anything? Do you need anything? To the young man here, what do you want? If somebody asks you this, I'll give you. Rabi'a ibn Ka'b al-Islami was very intelligent. He said, oh Prophet of Allah, amhilni. That's a very interesting question. I'm not going to respond right now, hilm. Let me think about it. Let me take my time. And the Prophet said, okay. He goes, comes next day, Ya Rabi'a, did you? Yeah, oh Prophet of Allah, let me think about it. If Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asks you, what are you going to ask? He's taking his time. Then he comes, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rabi'a, salni. Said, oh Prophet of Allah, as'aluka murafaqatuka fil jannah. I'm not just going to ask about Jannah. I ask you to be your companion in Jannah. You know what I want? I want your company. I love you so much. I want Jannah. So the best thing is, I want your companionship in Jannah. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, understanding, this is a man of insight. So said, Ya Rabi'a, man allamaka hada? Ya Rabi'a, who taught you this? He said, oh Prophet of Allah, nobody. And Allah inspired me. So he realizes now that Rabi'a ibn Ka'b al-Islam is a very special man. So he asks him the following, and he tells him the following, teaching him and teaching us. Ya Rabi'a, a'inni ala nafsika bi kathrati sujood. You want to be granted that? Aid me on yourself by prostrating a lot to me. The obstacle that exists between you and being with me, the obstacle between you and Jannah, is you. And the way I cross it is to go against yourself. Is to pray, to humble yourself, lots of sujood. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam answer is not just for Rabi'a. Anybody sitting here, do you want to be with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He's telling you, I am working at it. See, he didn't say do this. He said, أعني, aid me. I'm already trying. I want you to be with me. Can you help me so that you will be with me? I want you with me. And the obstacle is you, nothing else. It's not external. Can you please? Right? And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam asks Rabi'ah this question. Ya Rabi'ah, هل تزوجت? Knowing that this young man, 17, is not normal. He's a mature person. Ya Rabi'ah, did you get married? And he said, of course, O Prophet of Allah, no. I don't want to get married. Why? I don't want anything to distract me from your service. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam leaves. He comes next day, Ya Rabi'ah, هل تزوجت? Oh, Prophet of Allah, no. I don't want even to think about that. I just want to be with you. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi, and the third day, Rabi'ah thought to himself, what am I doing? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam knows me more than what I know myself. And if I want to serve him, but if he tells me that marriage is better, it must be better for me. He knows more. Do you see that? I'm going to get out of what I want and do what he wants. If he asks me again, I'm going to say, yes, I want to get married. And indeed, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam comes, asks him, and said, O Prophet of Allah, indeed. And the story goes on and on, and it's a beautiful story that I can continue the entire khutbah about the relation of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and this young man. He sends him to this group, a woman that he knows. See, he's a leader, he knows this young man. Can you imagine if a sheikh comes to, do you want to get married, young people? I know someone for you. Like, he knows sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But my point is the following. The relation of Rabi'ah ibn Ka'b al-Islami and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is more than love. It is a personal relation. Many of us sitting here today would say, oh, ya Rabbi, I would have loved to live in that time because I just want a personal relation. Is there any way to make my relation with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam personal? And the answer is yes. How? The hadith of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And this is what I want to discuss in our few minutes coming. When Abdul Rahman ibn Auf said, I was walking with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam one day, and all of a sudden he falls down. Falls down in sujood. Something happened. Sujood, thankfulness. And he said, it was so long, I was afraid that he passed away. So I came, O Prophet, what's happening? And he said, when he came out of the sujood, his face was illuminating. Full of light. He was happy. He was so happy. And he said, O Prophet of Allah, أرى في وجهك البشر. I see that there is something good happened. You're so happy. It must be something good. What happened? He said, Jibreel came to me. And he told me the following. من صلى عليك صلى الله عليه ومن سلم عليك سلم الله عليه. Jibreel came to me and told me, anybody from your ummah that sends peace and blessings unto you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send peace and blessings unto that person. And when I heard that, I was so happy, I bowed down in sujood. What do you see here? Why do you think that happened? Because he, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, there is a reason now for us to send peace and blessings on Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. What does it mean? Look, Prophet, brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, first this hadith, whoever sends peace and blessings on Muhammad, Allah sends peace and blessings unto him. I ask you, do you want peace in your life? I ask all the men sitting here, you know, especially if you're married, I just want peace at home, man. It's a battlefield, right? Many of us, that's what we want. I just want a peaceful home, Sakina. Do you want peace? Yes. The peace comes from the source of peace of Allah. Do you want peace? One way to get this peace, because it's not from you. Send peace and blessings on Muhammad, and Allah will send peace unto you. So if I find my life is turbulent, things are not going well, it is time to send peace and blessings on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is one. The second, which is actually very important, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, هُوَ الَّذِي يُصَلِّي عَلَيْكُمْ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ لِيُخْرِجَكُمْ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ. When Allah sends peace and blessings unto you, He brings you out of darkness into light. What does that mean? Have you ever been in a situation where you don't know what to do? It's dark. I don't know the answer, and I need an answer, and I keep thinking, and it's not clear. Do you want light? Because you can see with light. You want light? Send peace and blessings on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because when you do that, Allah's peace and blessing is an illumination for you by which you can see. That's a benefit to me. But how can I, when I say, please brothers and sisters, send peace and blessings on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He commanded us to do that. He said, especially on Friday, do that. You know what's the problem?
How do I do it? What do I imagine? How can I make it personalized? And I'm going to quote three ahadith for you so that it helps our hearts when we send peace and blessings on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It has an impact on us. Three things I want you to remember. Three ahadith. The first relates to the following. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam suffered a lot for us. He saw his companions tortured. His own daughter would come to him, "Yeah, dad, look at my hand." He suffered a lot. And we know Ta'if and other, a lot of things. Why? So that we can get the message. But he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said something amazing. He said the following: لكل نبي دعوة مستجابة تعجل بها وأردت أن أختبئ دعوتي شفاعة لأمتي يوم القيامة. First hadith. He said every prophet has a dua. If he uses, Allah will answer. Every prophet used it. Nuh alayhi salam used it. Sulaiman alayhi salam used it. Except me. I chose to delay my dua. I'm not going to ask. Although people he loves would come to him. Allah tad'u lana. Allah tastansir lana. People like Khabib, we've been tortured for 10 years. Can you imagine? Seeing the one you love being tortured and he comes to you. Please, you can make use your dua. Help us. He can make and make dua. All of people of Mecca will become Muslims. And he says, no, I'm not going to use my dua now. I'll choose to delay my dua. Why? Because there are people coming after me. Me and you, brothers and sisters. And they will need my dua on the day of judgment. I chose to make my dua to intercede for them on the day of judgment. I don't know if you understand what that means. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam chose to suffer, to be hungry, to be insulted for his daughters, for his sons. People died. Why? Because he thought of you and me. Because you need his dua more than he does. Nobody in this life loved me more than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said in another hadith, the companion says, كُنَّا نُمْسِكْ عَنِ الْإِسْتِغْفَارِ لِأَهْلِ الْكَبَائِرِ. We used not, you know, when people used to make major sins in Medina, I mean living with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and you go do something bad. The companion said, when we saw that, we used not to ask Allah to forgive those people, because how dare they do this? Till we heard Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, جَعَلْتُ شَفَعَتِي يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ لِأَهْلِ الْكَبَائِرِ مِنْ أُمَّتِي. I made my intercession on the day of judgment for people of major sins in this ummah. I just want you to understand, put one and two together now. What does that mean? The person sitting here who thinks I'm the worst person on earth, the people that cannot come to the masjid because we won't let them in because of the horrific things they did, they are the ones that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam thought about 1400 years ago. Those people need my help. And they don't need it in this life. They need it the most on the day of judgment. I am going to suffer. My companions are going to suffer so they can go to Jannah because I care about them. Nobody loved me like this. We all know the verse. The verse in Surah Al-Ma'idah when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks to Jesus, peace be upon him. أَأَنْتَ قُلْتَ لِلنَّاسِ سُبْحَانَكَ رَبْ. Allah asking Isa alayhi salam, did you tell people to worship you and your mother as gods other than me on the day of judgment? And Isa alayhi salam says, no, I never did that. I only commanded them with what you, but after I passed away, you know, people deviated. And then Isa alayhi salam says what? إِن تُعَذِّبْهُمْ فَإِنَّهُمْ عِبَادُكُمْ وَإِن تَغْفِرْ لَهُمْ فَإِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. If you were to torment them because they're misguided, they're but your servants. And if you forgive them, إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam heard this verse, he started crying. Ya Rabbi Ummati, Ya Rabbi. Abu Dharr narrates that one night he passed by the house of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and heard him reciting this verse the entire night. Reciting the verse and crying and saying, Ya Rabbi Ummati, Ya Rabbi my Ummah, Ya Rabbi my Ummah, the whole night. So he asked him the second day, O Prophet, what happened? He said, when I read this verse, you understand what was he thinking? Here is another prophet, Isa alayhi salam. He was with his people. He gave them the message of Islam. After he passed away, people deviated. Will that happen to my ummah? Will people after me, you and me, after he passes away, and he was asking Allah, please, not my ummah. Until Jibreel came down, according to the narration, said, Ya Muhammad, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling you, لن نسيئك في أمتك. Allah is telling you, we will not let you down in your ummah. فسألت ربي الشفاعة. And I asked Allah to give me the permission to intercede on the day of judgment. And he gave me that permission. And then he says, and I'm going to make it for people of major sins in this ummah. I love my son. When was the last time
that I spent the whole night making dua for my son. Nobody loved me like Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nobody on this earth. Do you understand the meaning if la qaddar Allah, يعني may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, imagine someone that was caught stealing from the masjid. You know, they had cameras, you know, he's opening the zakah box, stealing money. And of course, everybody will go so bad. What kind of thief is this? And now he's in court and he finds the following, that another person came and he's telling the following. I know what happened to you. I just want you to know. I sold my house and I took the money and I'm hiring a lawyer for you. And the man says, but I'm a thief. He says, yeah, I know, but you still have goodness in you. I'm willing to sell my house. I'm not going to have a house because I think you need a lawyer. Would you love that person? That's exactly what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is doing. I choose to suffer. My children will suffer. My companions will suffer. Because I think you need a lawyer on the day of judgment. You need me. The third hadith now on how, so do you understand this? He put me first. He put me before his needs. Now the third hadith, and we'll collect it all together. When he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِنَّ لِلَّهِ مَلَائِكَةً سَيَّحِينَ يُبَلِّغُونَنِي عَنْ أُمَّةِ السَّلَامِ. Allah has angels roaming around. Their task is, whenever somebody sends peace and blessings unto me, they deliver it to me. What does that mean? This is the key of having a personalized relation, because we think, well, I don't live in the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, right? So, no, wrong. Whenever you say, Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik ala Muhammad, an angel takes it, goes to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he will tell him, Hassan from California is sending you salam. And he responds back according to the hadith. You know what that means? If the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam entered from that door, would you say salamu alaykum? How would you say it? Say salamu alaykum, salamu alaykum. How would you, what kind of, salamu alaykum, O Prophet of Allah, right? Look at what we say in salah, in tashahud. What do we say? As-salamu alayka ayyuhan nabiy wa rahmat. It's as if he's present. It's not Allahumma salim, no. As-salamu alayka ayyuhan nabiy. It reaches him. You're giving him salam. It's as if you see him. Imagine that you see Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and you're giving him salam. How would you do it? Because it reaches him. It's as if an angel takes it and delivers it. How do I use all of this? Here is how, brothers and sisters. Things happen in my life. Sometimes something negative happens in my life and I'm distressed. Sometimes I need something so much from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I remember Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I remember how much he needed, his daughter needed, his companions needed, and he put himself before me. And then I tell myself the following. I really need to be safe. I really need money. I really need something, right? Young girls, maybe I need to get married, whatever you want. I really need something. Allah knows that. And I can choose to raise my hands and say, Ya Rabbi, give me. Good. But what if I remembered him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and said, he favored me over himself. Let me do the same thing. Ya Rabbi, I'm going to raise my hands. And instead of asking for me, instead of asking what I love, I'm going to do what you love. Ya Rabbi, Allahumma inni as'aluka an tusalli wa tusallim wa tubarik ala Muhammad. Oh Allah, I want something, but instead of asking for me, I'm going to ask you. Because I can't do it. I can't give anything to Muhammad sallallahu. What can you give him? I can't give him anything. I cannot do it enough. So Ya Rabbi, since I can do it, I ask you to raise in ranks, shower in mercy, raise in honors Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I favor him over myself. You know what's the reward of this? You know what the hadith says? If I was to do this in the time of need, I put Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam before me, you know what happens according to the hadith? إِذَن تُكْفَ هَمَّكْ وَيُغْفَرْ ذَنْبَكْ وَيُقْضَ دَيْنُكْ. Three things will happen. Allah, because Allah is generous, He will suffice you whatever it was is concerning. You don't need to ask anymore. Two, all your sins will be forgiven. Three, all your debts will be paid. So I put those ahadith together, brothers and sisters. And I know that my salah and salam is reaching Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I do it with a present heart. I sit down and I see my pain. And then I say, oh, he favored me over himself. Let me do the same thing. Ya Rabbi, I can't. You please send peace and blessings on him. You honor him. You raise him. I have a personal relation. Because on the day of judgment, I said, oh Prophet, it was me. Every day in California, I used to send you, remember, 100 day in the morning, 100 day, that was me. It's Hassan, remember, it reached you. I have a personal relation with him. الصلاة على النبي is a personal relation with محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أفضل المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه الطيبين الطاهرين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. هي صلى الله عليه وسلم told us من صلى علي حين يصبح عشرا وحين يمسي عشرا وجبت له شفاعتي. Whoever sends peace and blessings unto me 10 times in the morning and 10 times in the evening, my intercession for him on the day of judgment is incumbent. I will intercede for him. When you wake, you know, when I wake up in the morning, do you say good morning to your wife and your kids? You know, you give salam. How can I start my day not giving salam to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, knowing that it reaches him? How can I say, don't you say good night? Don't you say good night, the ones you love? How can't I say, knowing that? And he's telling us, please do that. It reaches me. He's happy. He wants that relation. He loves us. Say, please do that because I will intercede for you if you do that. How can't I do that, brothers and sisters? If anything from this khutbah, please beg of all of you, we cannot miss out on this. It's 10 times in the morning, 10 times in the evening. That's it. Every day with that intention, it reaches him. Send salam to him. You'll get nur in your life. You get light in your life. You get guidance in your life. How can't I do that? And one final thing. As-salatu ala nabi has so many applications. I'll give you one and we'll close with that. Practical. On how people that relate to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it helps them. Let's say I'm a person trying to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Night time I say, you know what, I'm not going to sleep until I pray some qiyam or maybe the witr, you know, the one rak'ah. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed the whole night. Why? For me. According to the hadith I narrated to you. Whole night because he's concerned and I can't pray one rak'ah. So no, tonight I'm going to pray. I'm going to pray two rak'ahs, inshallah. I go, bismillah, Allahu Akbar, and then what happens? قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ. That's it. And then I go to bed, and then most of us will feel bad. What if I didn't pray my qiyam? And I was just too tired. I was watching TV for 2 hours, but now I didn't pray my qiyam. I just go and I'm going to sleep. And then I beat up myself. What a fool. What a terrible person. You know, we start guilting and shaming. That doesn't work. Those who know Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam thinks differently. They think about what I just said. You said, oh, subhanaka ya Rabb, look at me. I can't pray two rak'ahs. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed the entire night. You know, if I tell you, can you help me lift the car outside? Can anybody come and can you lift that car over there? And you go and you try and it's very heavy. Like, I can't. And then I come with one hand and lift the entire car. What are you going to say? You have one of two options. You're going to say, oh my God, I'm so weak about yourself. Or you're going to say what? Oh my God, you're so powerful. You're so strong. Me unable to lift this car and you lifting it showed me who you really are. This is exactly what happens when I fail to worship Allah that way. Instead of focusing on my failure, I start, oh, that is why he was Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. With all what he had, he could pray. He could pray the whole night. And then what do? I want to praise him. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik ala Muhammad wa ala. So I sleep instead of blaming myself, saying salatu ala nabi. On the one that could do that which I can't. And he did it for me, so I would benefit. And I sleep lighthearted, brothers and sisters. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspire us to send peace and blessings on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala water the seeds of love of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in my heart and in your heart. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable us to follow with love Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه. اللهم حبب إلينا الإيمان وزينه في قلوبنا وكره إلينا الكفر والفسوق والعصيان واجعلنا من الراشدين. اللهم رد أمة محمد إلى التحقق بلا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله وصلى الله على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم وأقم الصلاة.
الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. حي على الصلاة، حي على الفلاح. قد قامت الصلاة، قد قامت الصلاة. الله أكبر، الله أكبر. لا إله إلا الله.
استوى اعتدل. There is a request for دعاء for the sick people and people that deceased. Please, I'll say their names, and in our sujood, let's make dua for them. Please come forward and make spaces, please. So there is special request for dua for sick people: Jamil Dahra, Abdul Razzaq Dahra, Harun Hussein, Omar Hussein, Sister Shughla Karzai, Ruqayya Said, Fartoon Ahmed, Abdul Hamid Isa, Muhammad Yusuf. May Allah Subhanahu wa Taala grant them speedy recovery, inshallah. Please remember them in your sujood. Make dua for them. There is a dua request for deceased people: Brother Asim Mursi, Brother Abdul Latif Jabri. May Allah Subhanahu wa Taala forgive them and grant them the suhbah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam in Jannah, inshallah. Stawa atadilu.